Hello everyone and welcome to the Virtual Future Stage at FutureFest 2018. My name is Guilaine Boddington and today I am joined by Rebecca Allen. Virtual Futures first occurred at the University of Warwick in the mid-1990s and it arose at a tipping point of a technologicalization of first world cultures. It casts a critical eye over the phenomenal changes in how humans and non-humans engage and with emerging scientific theory and technological development. Discussions like this help to complete the conference's aim to bury the 20th century and begin work on the 21st. So let's begin. So, Rebecca, thank you for joining us, actually for the whole weekend. It's great that you're here. And I wanted to just start by looking at the title of our talk, which is Presence in Virtual Worlds, and looking at the word presence, a word which obviously in majority, we immediately view it in terms of our living selves, the human, the agency, the selfhood that we are presence in everyday reality. But for your work over the last 30, 40 years, and for my world, we've been exploring this concept of presence within virtual side. Can you tell us a bit about the history of your work with presence within the virtual?
Yeah, it started a long time ago, actually in the 1970s. As an artist, I could see that the computer was going to be an important part of the world, of society, and I thought it was really important to get involved as an artist and help invent what the computer could be. And when I started to do this, I was one thing I was working on was three-dimensional computer modeling and graphics, and I specifically, in a way, I wanted to put the human in the computer. As you can imagine, this was a time when on a computer screen there was maybe some mathematical shapes, but I thought there has to be a human presence. And then metaphorically, I wanted to try to create three-dimensional human figures and then get them to animate, to come to life, which back then was still a research problem. So that's how I started with this important idea of human presence in the computer.
And then you did start to take the human into the computer. Can you tell us about those first experiments that you did?
Yeah, I think because I was fascinated about how human motion conveys behavior. We do so much with our bodies to convey our behavior. And so as I was bringing these characters to life, it kind of naturally aligned with choreographers. I worked early on with the Joffrey Ballet in New York to try to think of how we could have projected images with live performances. This was in the 1980, and then later, 82, with Catherine, a piece called The Catherine Wheel, yes, that choreographer Twyla Tharp put together. And so this was actually the Catherine Wheel. I created this human figure that moved, that danced, that represented St. Catherine in this dance piece. It was actually the first time, it was produced by BBC actually, and it was the first time the public had seen a computer-generated human on TV.
Amazing, absolutely great. Actually, for me, my own background, as you know, is also through dance and choreography. So I remember Catherine Wheel as part of my studies and remember that happening. And definitely it must, you know, influenced into my thinking too. So for me, my work's been more about remote stage, telepresence connections, and looking at the blending of the physical body in two live places or three live places into the virtual worlds between them. So. But you've moved on from doing, across those years, into working into some of the bigger music sector too, yeah, so.
With music videos?
Yes.
Well, it really, as an artist working in a research lab, I wanted to get this work out into the public.
Yes.
So
yes.
Catherine Wheel was great. And then MTV and stations like that, these music video stations were just coming around. And I thought, wow, this is a great way to expose the work and through creating music videos. And so I started with a piece, I did a couple pieces with Island Records back then, and 1983. And then in 1984, the German music group Kraftwerk contacted me. And I thought, oh, this is a dream collaboration, because they were trying to create a digital music sound, to just use digital technology and to create a new kind of sound. And I was trying to create a new form of digital art using the computer. So the idea that we could work together was perfect. And also, I knew of their work, of course, and they were making statements about technology and society, which I was doing as well. And they had made mannequins of heads of themselves. And at times on stage, they just put these mannequins, simple little robot forms, on stage. And they were saying, why do we need the humans there? You know, these robots can just perform the music. And I said, well, we're going into a virtual area with a video. Let me digitize your heads and create this music video called Music Nonstop. So that was a great collaboration. They actually went on. I created the wireform, and then they rendered models and the album covers, and I think it's gotten to be popular. And in fact, they still perform. After that, they started wearing these wireform costumes. So it's as if they were trying to bring the digital out into the performance in that way.
So yes, they were taking it really from the physical through, you were taking them into the virtual digital, and
right.
then they actually re-brought it back into the physical
right.
through the costuming and the on-stage side. It's fascinating.
Yes, yeah.
And that was in 1984, yes.
Well, so I started in 84. Yeah. By the right. time, they took a long time yes. to finish the album. So it came out in 86.
Right, yeah, so great. So actually just moving to our present time, yeah. I know that actually, you know, across these years, you've done many, many more things, and I've started to work well, quite a while ago, but I've seen your more recent work in virtual reality. And I know from my own work too, that the discussion of the, I'm going back to the word presence, yeah, has been for me quite frustrating to actually move through the 90s and 2000s and constantly not find this importance of our human presence, our liveness, etc., actually being considered in any way imperative to take through into our new virtual tools, yeah. So, you know, what do you feel about that? How has that been discussed? Do you feel, you know, across these last 10 years or so in this more virtual worlds area, virtual reality, gaming, etc., how has the concept of presence been approached?
Yeah, it's been interesting. And I always say that I think there's just too limited of a group of people working on inventing this kind of future. And they aren't understanding the importance of the body. I mean, I was influenced, like a lot of people, with science fiction writers. Take William Gibson, who wrote Neuromancer. But so often in science fiction, they talk about jacking into the brain, the body is yes. just called meat.
Yes.
So I could feel this sense of, oh, as we get more involved in virtual worlds, great, we're going to take leave our bodies behind and take our avatars or become our avatars. And this just seems like a horrible idea. I don't think people really want to be doing that. But I could see that even, you know, because I've worked in research labs my whole career, I could see that they weren't even anticipating social media. They weren't even thinking that the computer would have that much to do with our social lives. And that came as a big surprise to the industry. So I have just been trying to plod through and keep this notion of the human body, think about the importance, think about the role it's going to play now that we're moving into virtual and augmented realities. And where is our body going to be going?
Where is our body going to be? And I think for me and my group work, collective work with Shinkansen and Body Data Space across the last 20 years, that frustrated us a lot, as actually has been the real lack of awareness of this growing tech scene, of the fact that we somehow needed to keep the debate about presence at the forefront, but because actually they weren't even keeping the human body involved, yeah, that couldn't be possible, yeah. So,
Yeah, and when once I've more recently moved into virtual reality with the new systems now that came out just a couple years ago, that I thought, okay, let me get back into virtual reality because the quality of the image is good, the interaction is a lot better. And so often people say with virtual reality that, oh, it's so isolating, you're just alone. Mm-hmm. And now, in an interesting way, because social media has exploded, we live in a world where we share everything. And I was interested in this rare situation where you're in VR, you are alone with your body and your presence, but in fact, I find that you can be very aware of the role your body plays. You have a VR experience where, you know, that sort of a cheap trick is you take people to the edge of a cliff and you feel it in your body. Intellectually, you're saying, oh, this is just VR, there's no cliff, but it shows you how completely connected we are to our body, our mind, and how, you know, that is defining our place in reality. I mean, if the body isn't there, reality is something completely different.
No, and I really agree. I think sometimes when I see virtual reality set up at festivals where there might be 40 headsets in a room, say this size, with these actually quite often on these twirly chairs. Yeah, so yeah, it's like, you know, 40 of them sitting in rows, and they all go in and put these big boxes on their heads, and maybe they're sometimes in a multiplayer game, you know, game or platform or world, but often it's not. It's individual experiences. And it seems such an ironic scenario against the complex debate we have about the disconnectivity that is often been, you know, technology's been blamed for, that actually we then go and disconnect again and disembody ourselves by placing ourselves in a room with 40 people who we don't even talk to, you know, don't even have anything to do with, you know. So, but in your most recent work, which I saw in Montreal in May, that's May this year, 2018, what fascinated me about that was not just that I did, you're right, hold on to the sense of my own presence within it, because you give us a very intimate eye point of view and we have action that we can take, but you start the work by actually us seeing a figure coming towards us from the distance. So it's on the horizon, you suddenly realize someone's walking towards you, and this very beautiful avatar figure moves towards you and very precisely walks up to you and is actually looking at you, and the gaze of the other is upon you, yeah. And there, how have you been looking at presence there? Because I feel that really amplified a sense of presence within that work.
Exactly, yeah. And it was one of the experiments I wanted, you know, where we are, the way humans are, if someone gets into your personal space, you know, it's like defend. It's, you know, deep inside of our brain is a reaction. And I wondered, well, what if it's a virtual character who kind of comes into your personal space, and then and makes eye-to-eye contact you. And whenever someone, even a virtual character, does that, you can't help but respond to it. The eye-to-eye contact, and that someone getting that close to you. So I just want people to think about what's happening when this occurs, and the fact that even a virtual character can have an impact on our sense of presence and our relationship to another creature, even though it's completely virtual. This can be really powerful because we're going to be in these worlds more and more, and with these artificial humans or whatever kind of creatures they are, and we will respond to them. I don't think people are thinking deeply enough about what that's really meaning and what that is doing to not just our brain, but our whole body and our sense of presence.
Very interesting, because I do end up, and I'm sure you do often, actually, with younger groups coming to talk to us or people asking advice, etc., about how to start to work with the body, with presence, particularly in the last 5-6 years. It's suddenly there's something shifted in that world. A world which has been full of maybe, you know, wonderful tech people, but often actually the ones that are not so aware of their bodies, because they are actually geeking out coding like mad all the time, and it may be not such a problem that they're very head people. But of course it starts to become a problem, because of course they realize that there's not enough body knowledge, not enough sense of the self, of presence, of selfhood within it. So But they're starting to come and ask about how to integrate that. My advice is always just from the core of the beginning of the idea, get a biologist involved or get a dancer, choreographer involved, a neurologist, a physiotherapist, whatever. Just actually, we should be absolutely part of the group that's making that work. Now, you are working with neurologists, with Div. Tell us a little bit about how that is.
I've always been fascinated by neuroscience and and also about perception, how our perception works. And it's scientists have been advancing this. We're learning more and more about how this works. But this is how we perceive, you know, there's even proprioception, which is how we perceive ourselves, our body, and that's also key too. But I worked with, when I decided to do my first new VR piece 2 years ago, I wanted to, because of this thought of the brain, I wanted to work with neuroscientists, and I actually got a brain model, MRI data of a brain, and said, I want to get metaphorically, but literally inside the brain. So I worked at two labs, one at UC San Francisco and one at UCLA, the brain mapping center there. And once I got in the brain, cleared out all the white matter, it was a cave. It was really like a cave feeling, and I called it the brain cave, which is interesting because some people say art was, you know, defined in the cave. And but I also, in talking to neuroscientists and researching, I thought of VR as being an AR, and I thought of hallucinations. And as I did the research and talked to neuroscientists, more people have hallucinations than even admit to it. It's not that uncommon. But in a way, VR, AR is creating a sense of hallucinations. And I talked about that in the piece, or I sort of metaphorically represented that in the virtual reality piece. Because we are, I've also worked on eyeglass displays, which, you know, now you've got the big headsets, but of course we know they will go beyond Google Glass, they will be eyeglasses. But what that means is we really will, what I call, live in a liminal world, this world where we're in the physical reality, but we're also simultaneously in various kinds of virtual realities.
We could say to be blended.
We're doing that now, you know, walk down the street and people are like this. They want to be in both places. But then you have to ask, well, but what are we doing? What are we doing? You know, are we losing our body? Are we removing ourselves from physical reality?
No, it's very true. And I think it's really good to actually to wind up on that point, and in terms of taking it beyond the headset, the VR side, into the AR, augmented reality side, which I know you're very interested in. I am very much so too. Into this area where, yes, through, you know, the glasses or even to contact lenses eventually, whatever, even implants coming, that actually we are in a much more blended world of our physical selves and our data selves, where they can come together and exist for both of us. And we can also, what's fascinating about that, of course, is that we can send our data selves, our data bodies elsewhere too, into telepresence robots or into avatars across time and space and exist in multiple places as ourselves.
But what are ourselves? It's not what we have now. We are going to, this could dramatically and profoundly change humanity too. And I think that's why I work with neuroscientists, people, and talk to philosophers, people who are really thinking about where we're going with this. But not enough people are, and not enough people from enough disciplines are seriously talking and thinking about it.
So I guess our little call here would be for more interdisciplinary work in this area, where actually groups that come together, not just for yourself and me who have that chance to do that for universities and arts work, but actually many more into the tech industry, have the chance to work in a much more interdisciplinary way with the top level tech guys, but also, and girls, brilliant women out there too, but also with the neurologists, the biologists, etc. Yeah.
And the artists. The artists have to be part of this too.
Well, thank you very much, Rebecca. I want to remind those that interested in the future, some things that may seem imminent or inevitable may never actually happen. Fortunately, our ability to survive the future is not contingent on our capacity for prediction. Although sometimes, and on those much more rare occasions, something remarkable comes of staring the future deep in the eyes and challenging everything that it seems to promise. Thank you very much.
Thank you.